gentlemen, and welcome to Kinguin Pro League 2015, Week 7, Day 1 on Tuesday with me, Lothar, who's back from Sea Story Cup, I believe, like a lot of people, in fact.
32 players there, so quite a bunch.
Yeah, we had a lot of people over there, which is exactly why we didn't get a show on Thursday. As a result of that, you know, a lot of the players that were supposed to play last week on Thursday had to delay their matches to... We'll postpone that to the end of the season, effectively have one more day of matches. But today we're back on schedule. I think we'll have a show on Thursday as usual, since there is no Seed Story Cup number 4 that I'm aware of coming up in the next week.
We'll have an usual show on Thursday, but without me this time, because I'm off. I'm traveling on Thursday, so someone else will be taking my place. Yeah, I'm not sure who, but there will be games on Thursday.
All right, so that's pretty good. So today we have 5 matches to cast for you, as usual. At least normally we do have 5. The first 4 players that we're going to be casting today will have their current win rate adjusted as a result of Masson having to drop out of the league. Masson announced that he would have to quit the KPL event. So as a result, what was done with his matches is that all the wins and losses that were attributed to matches against Masson were counted out. Effectively, the group that Masson was in was reduced to 9 players, which means that in effect, those wins or those losses that players had against him will be canceled. So Sho, who is currently 3-3, is going to go down to 2-3.
Garo is currently...
Yeah, it's unfortunate. He loses a win, right? I mean, two players recover a loss and two players lose a victory. So Sho is going to go 2-3 instead of 3-3. Gara is going to be 3-2 instead of 3-3, which is really positive for him. Strifecrow going from 5-0 to 4-0. Not really, I mean... Still a perfect score, you know. Yeah. It's no big deal for him. And Zixo is going to move from 2-4 to 2-3. So effectively, Sho and Zixo are going to be on equal footing here.
Yeah, it might kind of feel unfair for the players that were already playing. But on the other hand, if you think about the upcoming upcoming matches that will be done by Masson, it doesn't make any sense to give forfeits by him not being able to play. So it makes more sense to erase the matches that we had already than to force people into forfeiting, I mean to getting, you know, free wins.
Yeah,
because then it's unfair for the players that were already playing against him
and lost. In fact, like if the players who already played against Masson and had to fight for their victory, it feels a little awful if somebody else is, you know, afforded a free win on the back of it, a bye, if you will. And it's also pretty bad for the players who lost against Masson. So we ended up just canceling all those matches, and the scores will be adjusted so the players in the group with Masson will simply have one less match to go through, which means they'll be up, or down rather, to 8 matches total, as opposed to 9. So this will change a little bit of the scoring, but ultimately, it doesn't make a difference since the top 3 from each group is going to be moving on to the playoffs regardless. That is still going to be the standing ruling. So as of now, we still have, you know, a few more weeks to go. We have, I believe, this week and then 2 more on the back of this, right?
Well, all people have to play 8 matches in the Alliance group, so let me check the ranking.
Yeah, I think this is, we're week 7, we should have 9 weeks of playoffs totally, and then a possible, we'll have the 10th week of, we have 9 weeks to prepare for the playoffs, and then a 10th week of the playoffs with quarterfinals, semifinals, and finals.
Well, we are ending the league at 30th of April.
Yeah, so that's coming up.
So that's 3 weeks.
About 3 weeks at the very most. So today, Sho versus Gara, we have Strifecrow versus Zixo, RDU versus Reynad, Savich versus Firebat, and Firebat is going to be going up, you know, against Savich, and also then right afterwards against Strifecrow. So Strifecrow and Firebat will both be playing 2 matches today, which means they have there's still a lot of room for variance as far as these scores. You know, we have a currently established ranking, but we're still 3 weeks away from the total ending, so there is still a lot of room for surprises and upheavals.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to today's match between RDU and Reynad. They like each other so much.
It's like, I'm sure, you know, they do.
this will be the star match of the day.
Yeah. I think RDU's played a total of 6 matches so far, but Reynad has only played 5. Yep. So RDU is 2-4 right now in the league. Reynad is 2-3. Both of them have only 2 wins. But if RDU wins this, he will be 3-4 to Reynad's 2-4. So there's a possibility that RDU can put Reynad exactly where he is right now, and that would probably allow him to at least equalize the score. I mean, RDU has had a really rough run in KPL so far.
That's very true. Many players struggled with the results, like Frezor, Amaz, Orange, which currently is the champion of IEM and Seed Story Cup. And then Xixo had also the 2-4 result, but now he has the 2-3 result because of Mastan dropping out. So it's not so bad for him.
Yep.
He can definitely still climb up.
Yeah. So before we move on to the matches and everything, I just want to remind you guys that KPL, Kinguin is still looking for casters. If you want to be casting Hearthstone at any point in time, just give it a shot. There, you've got nothing to lose. Take a VOD of yourself talking over a game. Send it to esports@kinguin.net and you might be contacted to do some kind of cast off in their studios. So that's an opportunity if you're willing to get into casting for Hearthstone. That's something you want to do. And also, this weekend, you know, especially sort of after, you know, we have the matches on Tuesday and Thursday, there's going to be the recap as well, I believe, from Callum Leslie, and then we'll have the Kinguin for Charity event. That's going to be the Easter edition for 2015, so that's another Kinguin, you know, based tournament. We'll have 16 players, and everybody will try to get it for the first place, effectively. So it's all going to go for Child's Play Foundation. We've already done a few of those events so far. This is not a new thing, but it is a recurring one, and this is not going to be the last Kinguin for Charity event, as far as I'm aware. Child's Play Foundation is an organization that is heavily backed by Kinguin at the moment, so don't forget to watch that after the end of the week, but we'll remind you on Thursday in case you forgot. We definitely will.
Yeah, and I know that Forsen will be playing in this one.
Forsen? Really?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I mean, I'll watch it, I guess. He's got enough fans that the problem is they have to put the music, right? You can't just have Forsen alone. They have to put the music that goes, like, you have to have Plug DJ on when you play Forsen in the match, right?
Maybe actually we'll do it. That would be so funny.
Yeah, after Sea Story Cup and what was the house cup that
Via
was
game?
Via Game, yeah. After Via Game and Sea Story Cup, I think we can afford putting Plug DJ in the background of a Forsen match. That would be quite nice. So, that being said, we have the classes for the first player, Sho versus Garra. So, Sho is going to be playing Hunter, Mage, and Rogue, and Garra is going to be playing Druid, Paladin, and Shaman. Again, bringing the token Shaman. Sure, go ahead.
Before we started the broadcast, you asked me, how much of Hunters do you think we'll see today? And we didn't make a bet.
And right.
We can still make it, right? We will have how many players today? 10 players, right?
Well, yeah, we have 10 players total.
10 players. Okay, so we already know that Sho is running a Hunter and Garra isn't. So we can still make a bet for the next 8 players. So I would say we'll see 6 Hunters.
Yeah, I was going to say 6 as well. So I was pretty sure 2 people would maybe not bring Hunter by personal preference and stack heavily against it, but we can't make a bet if we have both the same result, right?
Well, then we
I'm gonna
can say,
say I'm gonna
exact
say seven.
Players. We can say the exact players.
Okay,
I
think Firebat is not gonna bring Hunter, and I think Savage is not gonna bring Hunter.
Then you're bringing 5 because Firebat is playing twice today. Haha.
Yeah. Okay. I'll say 5. I'll say 5. You say 6. I think Firebat and Savage will not bring Face Hunter.
Okay. We'll see how it goes. Within the whole day.
Yeah. So, in effect, the reason we're kind of betting on this is because, well, Face Hunter and Midrange Druid have been rocking Hearthstone right now. It's crazy. Yeah. I mean, Emperor Thorsain, we knew was going to be, you know, like when we saw the card, we knew it was going to be good in general, but we knew it was going to be obscene for Druids. And that's turned out to be absolutely true. It just compounds the Wild Growth Innervate, you know, ramp that they've already got. So I think Emperor is overall a pretty cool card. Like, it's a pretty balanced card, but I think for Druid specifically, it poses a bit of a problem. And Face Hunter is right now punishing. I mean, it's a heavily refined deck at this point. Like, Face Hunter has gotten refined to the point where
it doesn't even have a spot to, like, move, right?
Yeah, it's really hard to find a slot with, like, to put specific cards in. Sometimes you want to put an extra tracking, a Hunter's Mark, and you just don't know what to take out, so it feels very goofy at times. The deck has been heavily refined, and it's punishing, you know, unrefined decks left and right, like, massively.
Sure. Even refined decks. Yep. Because, you know, sometimes you have just a bad matchup, and that's basically it. And
right.
Even with a warrior, which should be really prepared against a hunter, He can still lose when he has a bad opening hand, and he will be punished for the first three turns. An example, when he will draw just only Alexstrasza into Grommash, into Baron Geddon, into Ragnaros. Okay, GG, what can you do with that?
Yeah, you have two turns to find the cards you need.
Exactly.
You have like three turns at the very most to find the cards you need, then you just get snowballed out of the game more often than not. So it's a very punishing deck. It's a deck that plays itself very frequently. There are certain key points where you can make decisions, but as a general rule, it's a deck that it's kind of the, we talked about that before, but it's the default deck, right? If I were to make, like if I gave you an opponent that didn't have cards to play and he just had 30 health, and I told you kill it as fast as possible, you will play a Hunter deck with, you know, Bluegill Warriors and Reckless Rocketeers, Leeroy, and everything else that charges. Mm-hmm. But then, as soon as you face an opponent that can actually play cards, then you start switching the bad cards out, like Bluegill and Reckless Rocketeer, and now you put in Explosive Traps, and Bows, and Unleash the Hounds. Because those will, you know, whenever he plays something, you punish him even further for playing those cards. So Hunter has a lot of tools to deal amazing amounts of damage on its own, but it's also got ways to punish people who try to apply counter pressure very effectively.
I'm still hoping for a return of a Trap Hunter. That was my favorite deck in beta. You know, with huge creatures, Baron Geddon, all the traps. Well, maybe not all the traps, but most of the traps. Both.
All the traps!
It's a trap. But seriously, that was a really great deck to play. And I'm looking forward to the next expansions. Maybe something will change. Maybe the metagame will change so much that we'll be seeing a comeback of that kind of archetype.
Yeah, I guess the one thing that I have to commend Blizzard for making, like the card that I think GVG brought that made the most people happy was Anti-Healbot, at least. It's one of those cards that until it's published, you don't really think about it too much, but then when it comes out and you get to play around with it, you realize just how much it allows you to counter those hyper-aggressive decks at times. If you draw into like two Anti-Healbots during a matchup, that can be just game-winning. 8 health is a lot. It's like playing Healing Touch. We were already seeing Healing Touches.
It's even more. And,
yeah, it's more than that because you've got a body.
Yeah, if you play against a deck that doesn't have charged creatures, an example against Zoo, right? There's only two Doom cards. So when you play this Anti-Killbot against a Zoo, you basically gain not only 8 points of life, but also the amount of damage that Anti-Killbot will drain himself, right?
Yeah, and the minion he trades into. So it's about 15 health mitigated, possibly. Like, you can go from 8 and you trade into a 3-2, let's say, with the Anti-Killbot. It took 3 damage and it killed a minion that was going to deal recurrent damage. So you've got a lot more health than just the 8 baseline, which makes the card probably one of the most beloved tools of the mid-range and probably control archetypes against the aggro metagame in general. And I think if we see more cards like these coming out in the future from Blizzard, we could see a shift to a slower Hunter deck. But until then, I think they have a huge incentive to just keep,
pushing aggro to the limits.
Yeah, exploiting their aggressive potential to the extreme, really.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And what is funny is also that the best heal card you can put into a priest deck is Anti-Killbot.
Yeah.
A mech is better at healing than a priest.
Yeah, you would think that's not the case. But I was talking about that recently to somebody who was saying, you know, we need more class-specific cards that do specific things, so each class has a super good flavor. And this is true to an extent. It would, you know, if you give more traps to hunters, maybe they'll be more inclined to play more traps. But then you have cards like Mad Scientist that come out and start giving traps viability or secrets viability, no matter which class they're in, except Paladin, of course.
The outcome of the Mad Scientist is less meaningful. Yeah, less meaningful and valuable than, an example, in Hunter, and I won't even say what about Mage, because Mage is just ridiculous with Mad Scientist.
Yeah, it's just there are cards to incentivize specific playstyles, and Anti-Healbot is one that doesn't incentivize a playstyle, but it denies the hyper-aggression in many ways. And Sludge Belcher and Anti-Healbot are the go-to anti-aggro tools that a lot of mid-range and, you know, control decks tend to go to as soon as they need something to tech against aggro. But if we see more of that, then things could change. But if Anti-Healbot, for instance, had been a priest card, it would be complete trash. right? Like, it fits the priest archetype in that it heals you, but you just don't see it played in priest at all, or almost not at all.
Maybe then you would play the 5-5-5 mech.
The upgraded repair bot? Yeah. Please, no. But that's the thing that I find interesting, is that if anti-killbot wasn't a card, the metagame would be so much different. Because it would be so much easier to apply insane amounts of pressure that's impossible to answer.
I don't see Handlock being viable without the Healbot.
You know what I mean? Like, this card alone enables a lot of mid-range and control decks, and I think that's something that I find super interesting, and I hope Blizzard will push that in the future, and maybe we'll see a Trap Hunter come back with a heavy focus around, you know... Like, we used to see Snipe, right?
Yeah,
like, we used to see people playing Snipe. It was cool. It would kill Azure Drakes and Gadget Sands, but now that that's phased out, it's a little tougher to justify.
I pulled off a Reynard at the last year IEM because I was playing Snake Trap and Snipe in my Hunter deck to, you know, be ahead of the metagame, and
I failed.
Because I predicted that there would be so many Azure Drakes in the metagame. Yeah. That would be such a sweet move to pull off, you know, with the Snipe.
Yeah.
It failed.
Well, the thing is, funny enough, there's a Control Hunter deck that was publicized recently, I think, on Reddit, that was exactly running one Snipe and one Snake Trap, and that was it. And then it was running, you know, the whole Steam Middle Sniper shenanigans, and apparently the guy got to Legend with it. I don't think I've seen him do it, so I wouldn't know if for sure if that's what he ran or if he just tried to troll everyone, but it contained one Snipe and one Snake, which I thought was interesting considering all we see anymore. Even in mid-range Hunter, you don't see Snipe. So I was pretty happy to see that somebody was trying something else in Freezing Trap or Explosive Trap. That was a pretty cool sight.
Yeah, true. Okay, so are the players ready? Let's see.
They should be at least getting ready at the moment. So let's look at the lineups. No, he's coming down. I'm just curious to see which one of these two players you think is going to be having an edge here, because Hunter Mage Rogue from Show versus Druid Paladin Shaman feels like both players are playing complete extremes, like different extremes of the metagame.
Druid Paladin and Shaman. I don't think that the Shaman will be the super aggressive one or the Fel Reavers.
Fel Reavers, oh my god, right. You know, that'd be nice though if Gar brought that.
Well, it was heavily present in Seed Story Cup, but I don't think Garo will go for that. I mean, he plays Shaman so well. I mean, the mid-range controlish one. I don't think he will want to go for the more aggressive one unless he thinks it's so OP that it has to be just played. Maybe that's the thinking, because the aggro Shaman might be really well equipped to play against the mage and rogue, but it will be a struggle against the hunter.
It always is, but he's got a paladin in his lineup, so he could always punish the hunter fairly well with the paladin.
With the paladin? That would have to be like a super defensive control paladin.
Yeah, exactly, like the heavy double heal bot, double lay on hands and everything paladin deck that tends to be run. I mean, this is one of my favorite archetypes personally. I like mid-range, but I feel like heavy control is more suited to the current meta nowadays, since, you know, Hunter's just everywhere, effectively. Even Zoo has come back, actually, which I find
I was playing Zoo in the top 8 of Seed Story Cup. Oh, you know what? I was actually kind of pissed at myself that I changed from Handlock to Zoo in the top 8, because I really was so fond of my Handlock during both of the group stages. I wanted to play it in the top 8 too. But I had to submit the deck lists for top 8 before the whole tournament began. So I was thinking, okay, I can maybe pull off a surprise factor here and go with the Zoo. And, well, the Zoo won me a game, so it wasn't so bad. But still, I would rather play with the Handlock there.
Yeah, well, I think Handlock in general is more consistent for tournament play, whereby because the game is longer and you have more decision, you know, lines of decision to take, it tends to be a little bit more subtle in the way that you can control the outcome. Sorry about that. I kind of zoomed out and got blurry. You can control the outcome of matches with Handlock a bit more than with Zoo, even though it's a board control oriented deck. What I'm curious about is, like, Bane of Doom and Zoo. seems to be very, very prevalent nowadays. And I wonder if that's not the tool, you know, the change that Blizzard made to Bane of Doom to where it can summon any demon, if that's not what enables the archetype in a way.
Yeah, well, I played the Bane of Doom in Story Cup and I got Infernal.
Infernal, so was, you can get everything. Like Infernal Floating Washer, there's so many good cards now that you get from Bane of Doom.
Like the game was already over, but after the Bane of Doom, it was like a just insult to the injury, you know, like adding salt to the cut.
You seal the game. You just like you snap that down. Like sure, you could get Flame Imp. Sure, you can get Void.
Flame is not bad, dude.
It's not even bad.
Yeah, you pay 5 mana for 2 points of damage, which basically trades for it's 1 for 1, right? And most likely it's 1 for 1. Maybe like a 1.5 for 1, and then you get a Flame Imp. That's not bad. That's not bad at all.
It's not horrible, but it's like, you know, you're paying 1 mana for the 2 damage because it's an arcane shot or holy smite, and then you're paying, 4 mana for the flame imp. The value is not great, but on average, it's going to give you much more value than the cost of the card.
But you have the card value, right? Because that two cards, basically. That's it.
Two cards in one, in effect.
The only bad outcome, I think, is the blood imp. That's it.
Oh yeah, that's the only really terrible one. The rest are all acceptable. Voidwalker can give you a bit more reach, protect your minions, protect your face. And if you do score something huge like a Doomguard or a Mal'Ganis, then you're set. Yep. I mean, this is just incredible.
That's very true. Yep. And you can also get the Pitlord, right? Which is a 5/6.
Pitlord as well. Can you get Imp Gang Boss? I haven't really checked.
Yeah, you can.
I've never gotten it from the Bane of Doom. I was just wondering if they already added it since it came out in BRM, the second wing. So if you can get, Imp Gang Boss, that gives it even more value. And I just love how much, flavor that's bringing. And with the advent of Demon Wrath coming up, the 3 mana Hellfire for non-demons, the Consecration for non-demons.
Yeah.
Will that make a Zoo demon deck crop up that's going to be really, really tough to deal with? I mean, I'd love to see something like that, like a mid-range. It's more like a mid-range demon lock at this point. Let's be honest, like the Zoo has transitioned a bit more to the mid-range side than the, uber aggro. It's still playing Direwolf Alpha. Some versions still run Creepers, but...
Well, that's a board control card. There were... really early on, there were Zoos that were playing Wolf Riders and Arcane Golems and Power Roamings and Soulfires for 0.
Yeah.
And that kind of stuff. And also maybe a Faceless, like one Faceless.
Yeah, to copy whatever it is they could get from it. Like a Wolf Rider plus Faceless, or you just Arcane Golem PO, Power Overwhelming that is, and then Faceless, and you get a massive amount of burst for no effort at all. I mean, that was those were like the early, higher, more aggressive Zoo versions, but I wonder if we'll see a slower one come out as a result of Demon Wrath coming around.
I don't think so. The problem with Demon Wrath is the fact that it only deals 2 points of damage for 3 points of mana. Like, you can't play other creatures than demons. When you think about Hellfire, right? It's 4 mana for 3 damage, but the 3 damage is really crucial. It can...
The range is big, very, very big.
Between 2 and 3, it's much bigger. Between 3 and 4. The next step would be 4 and 5, in my opinion, an example, right? Because when you can deal 5 damage AoE, you basically clear everything in the game.
Yeah, you do.
Belchers, you get rid of Belchers, Lotep, Emperor, basically
Sylvanas,
the most
name it. Sylvanas, everything just goes off the board effectively. All right, well, I will see how it goes. I just want to see it, at least in Handlock or in mid-range Warlock deck, see how it goes. So that being said, we're on to our first game. Sho will be playing as Hunter Furs versus Garr's Druid. So this may be one of the most metagame, like the actual metagame matchup, whereby it's Face Hunter versus possibly a fast Druid with Empress Thorsain.
Maybe Garr will pull off his standard-ish Druid with Ancient of Wars.
I think, was he running 2 of those or 1 of last time we saw him play?
I don't know how much, but there was a 1. And when I think of Garr, I always have that card in my mind. Like Ancient of War, boom, drop them. 5 tens.
You have to think of Garr, like he's a player who plays cards that are largely unused. You see him just try out all sorts of stuff. And as a result, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw something less of a standard Druid deck. I mean, it's going to be fast Druid, I don't doubt it. But it could be it could include cars that you would be surprised by.
True. I will be jumping to the game in a few seconds. Oh wow.
All right, we're assigned to the game, guys. Yeah. You will love this.
Oh,
you
look at this. Do you see that?
Oh,
that's
my
Ancient of
goodness.
Wars. I was right. And there's a Blackwing Technician.
So Blackwing Technician here, I think you have to keep Ysera just for the Blackwing Tech. It sucks, right? But you have
to.
So?
I think against a Face Hunter.
It's a 3-5. It's
the
2-4
is still relevant.
Right.
It basically trades for two minions anyway. So the 3 points of damage won't matter.
It could trade up to 3 with Blackwing. As a 3-5, it could trade up to 3, right?
Yeah, but I'm not sure if you would stick to that.
We'll have to see what he does. All right, so the game is getting on, and we see the usual leper gnome trying to hug everyone. So he did mulligan away Ysera, as you mentioned.
I'm not sure if he mulliganed the Blackwing, you know? I'm not sure.
I think he kept it. I think he would keep that.
Defensive lineup. I really like this. Let's see if it will matter.
Yeah, let's see if playing a defensive deck will change anything against the Plague of Hunter.
So what do you think about innervating Blackwing Technician here?
Do you go turn to innervate Coin Belcher? No. I think innervating the Blackwing is good. The drawback is that Glaive Zuka effectively would give your opponent the ability to trade into it afterwards.
I feel that's still okay.
Yeah,
you won't point out hero power because then you have... Well, you maybe do, actually. You have the ref for turn two juggler or whatever. But that would go with the Blackwing.
Yeah, I like the Blackwing quite a bit more, to be honest. I feel like even as a 2-4, now Sho knows that
he has no dragons in his hand.
Yeah.
So much information for the Face Hunter. Like, it's so important.
Yeah, the Hunter needs, you know, all the information he can get to make sure that he makes the most educated guesses at every turn, because misplaying as a Face Hunter is really punishable.
I'm not sure if that was sarcasm, but that was actually true.
Okay, sure. Let's pretend it was. So... What he knows is that there's no Ysera, right? That's what he knows. There's no Azure Drake. So he has some you know measure of information. Yeah, so swipe is more likely than not.
you can misplay as Face Hunter.
I've seen
that so much. People playing really weirdly with the Face Hunter, and this can matter. This can matter a lot.
Oh no, I know it does. I know it does, Lothar. I'm just being facetious here. There is a measure of scale to Face Hunter. It's just that it goes unnoticed a lot of the time because sometimes the games don't last long enough for you to realize.
Yeah. Now Garo will have a cool turn with a coin keeper, silence the dude, and then kill it off with Blackwing Technician.
This is perfect, actually.
He will get 5 points of damage next turn because that will be... Will he play Explosive Trip with attacking with the bow? I would say I would. Because
I would maybe just Explosive Trap Hero Power and get a second bow charge.
Well,
right?
then you delay your Ignihole Bow for the next turn.
Yeah, but you get an extra... you're right.
But you can have a really dead turn. Like an example, you know, if you draw a second spell, then your turn 5 is awful. So I would say it's face with the bow, Explosive Trap, Hero Power, because it's still additional 2 points of damage, and I think you won't have you won't have 3 turns to attack with that bow, you know? This game might end just really
very
faster
soon
than that.
Well, he's considering the attack phase bow, maybe just rebow, in fact, instead of Hero Power. Is that ever something you do? I mean, I really do like the Explosive Trap line of play, but he might just throw away the...
So he will go with bow explosive type next turn?
Yeah, definitely.
Well, maybe that makes sense, but I really don't like being mana inefficient with the Hunter.
With the hero power, you mean? You want to weave in that hero power as much as possible.
Now we can think that Druid will have 32 points of life instead of 30. Because you just skipped 2 points of mana.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Sengen.
Yeah, I mean, it's an obviously super defensive Druid deck. You know, it's kind of a... It's kind of a ramp. I guess it's ramp, actually. Oh,
what
oh
I said, those what will I just be said.
So important for show to find. But oh, my goodness.
Now. Gaara would be at 10, not at 12.
Yeah. He would be at 10 health, which would effectively mean near lethal. Gaara's going to have to drop that Sludge Belcher like no tomorrow, and he does in a split second. Yeah, you really can't afford taking any more damage. If you can
certainly
avoid it.
Close to being dead, no matter what.
Yeah, Iron Beak Owl, and you possibly even just kill Command Phase here to make sure you get the damage
yeah,
in.
Yeah, you
it's
do.
It's pretty obvious.
Well, maybe you just Hero Power and Explosive Trap. That's also good. You have the Animal Companion. So I would say Explosive Trap and the Hero Power.
Really?
Or maybe not. Nah.
Because the problem with that play
kill,
is low
kill him
I
next
guess.
Turn. Yeah. You kill him next turn, never mind. Oh.
So early.
There's no way Gaara can live, right?
What if he plays Wrath and gets an Earthening Farseer? Would that even save him?
I don't think he plays.
Actually, it wouldn't here. Well, no, he'd be... Yeah, he could have lived given different circumstances, but this is not going to be enough. He will, in fact, just die.
Skill commanded.
Yep. Skill command, boys. Hashtag esports. Doesn't even play the beast. Doesn't want to BM and show, hey, I top deck the beast. Just is going to go for 3 damage. Doesn't want to reveal the animal companions because, you know, he might not run them, right?
Yep.
Right. Let's believe it. Alright, so... Show versus Gaara. Show takes the first one with Facehunter. It's really no surprise. I wouldn't say that in general, Facehunter can get games against anyone, but because this is Conquest format, we will not be seeing another one of those games from Show. He'll have to move on to his Mage or his Rogue. He has Hunter, Mage, and Rogue in his lineup. Hunter's now out, so he has to win with Mage and Rogue versus the lineup from Gaara. How do you think Mage and Rogue fare against this Ram Druid?
Well, the Druid might just crush the Rogue.
That's what I suspect, with the amount of big health minions.
Yeah, it's... How to deal with Sengen? It's basically the same as Yeti, so the most common way to deal with that is basically an agent with backstab and dagger, or Eviscerate is really bad.
Eviscerate is pretty terrible, yeah, I was going to say, but I think most of the time it's going to come down to those backstab... Plus SI, plus dagger play, or deadly
yeah,
poison,
or deadly
backstab.
Poison, deadly poison agent, something like that. But if he doesn't have the way to deal with the first taunt creature, then every single additional taunt creature is basically game.
Yeah, especially like we've seen so many variants of Rogue. There's a deck that I love a lot that we've seen very little of recently, which is the Dragon Rogue with the advent of Blackwing Technician coming around and Malygos and Azure Drakes. This is a deck that has been played in ladder at high legends, but you just don't see much of it at all. I haven't seen any of it in C-Story Cup. I don't know if there was any of it, but I don't remember seeing any. I think most of it is still Tinker Sharp Sword oriented, but I feel like Dragon Rogue, once the entire BRM will have been revealed or released, we'll see a bit more of that. So maybe there's going to be some kind of budding archetype here from Show.
True. Well, on C-Story Cup, you didn't see any kind of dragon decks yet.
Yeah, it's not ready yet.
Yeah, not ready yet. And this upcoming week will feature the Dragon Consort, right?
Right.
Paladin deck. So I think this will spawn a lot of Paladin dragon decks because it's a 5/5/5 for, with built-in innervate for your next dragon.
Yeah,
I think
it's gonna
that's
be
pretty powerful.
Pretty strong. All right, so Show is going to be picking up his Mage against Gaara's Druid for the next match. So Gaara is going to stick to his guns and try again with the Druid, which I think is a good call. Ram Druid against Mage is easier than Fast Druid a lot of the time, I feel, just because of the way that they're forced to use their Fireballs and Frostbolts on your big taunts to do anything.
Well,
I find it easier to win with.
Whatever the archetype of the Mage is, if it's a Freeze Mage, Mech Mage or Temple Mage, almost every single one of that is a good matchup for the Mage.
Yeah, definitely. But it's better to be playing Ramp, I think, than playing Fast Druid in this specific case.
Probably yes. Oh,
yeah.
Well, now it seems like a different match. You know?
Yeah, now it doesn't look the same. So now we're getting into the game. We will be seeing, it's going to be Freeze Mage versus Ramp Druid. Wait, Ramp, there's Paladin Shredders in there. So yeah, apparently he didn't deviate too much with Sengins and Shredders. So what did Gaara cut out of his deck? Wild Growth? No, no way.
No way.
No way.
There's no way he could have cut that. That's impossible. So will Freeze Mage has a decent start all day. He has the Arcane Intellect, which is very crucial. And also Gaara missed his Wild Growth, unless he doesn't play those. But that's almost not possible.
Yeah, it's been seen in Token Druid, but that goes way back. So Gaara will have the information that shows playing Freeze Mage with the Acolyte of Pain or some kind of a slower value mage. But Sho is very well known for playing. What the hell is this?
Why is he playing Toshli? Only for the stats? Because it's the 6 mana minion that deals with Belchers and Emperors and...
Yeah, and everything else.
Maybe he plays Gazetan.
Maybe he plays Gazlo.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no. There's no way. If Gaara plays Gazlo, that's it. I'm throwing the towel. That is it. I am out. All right. Well, Sho's got to figure out what he wants to do with this Acolyte of Pain. If you want 4 mana, I think there's a good play for him. Arcane Intellect is probably the safest way to go about this. Now the question is whether you trade or not, since you know the opponent is, you know, possibly going to silence this, or he keeps it for Doomsayer.
What do you want to draw against the Druid as soon as possible? First Nova and Doomsayer, right?
Against Ramp, I'd say so. I mean, Ramp is a much different matchup for Freeze Mage than Fast Druid, because they might not be running double combo. You saw Ascension, so you may be thinking the deck is a bit on the slower end. You saw Blackwing Technician in the previous game, so there's something a little different about this Druid deck than what you might expect.
Well, when you saw the Blackwing Technician, you can for sure say that he will have 2 Usher Drakes and more, right? So
yeah.
What do you run more in a Druid, in a Ramp Druid? Probably Icera, right?
Yeah,
Alexstrasza doesn't make any sense, I think.
Well, if you play a combo, it's not terrible, but it's not necessarily going to be the best. Yeah, I think Icera is the most commonly accepted dragon to run in pretty much every deck, in fact.
What about Deathwing?
Maybe. Maybe one day.
Well, the problem with the Druid deck is the fact that you have so much high mana cost creatures that you probably, when you will play the Deathwing, we probably will discard like 8 cards.
Yeah, I don't think that's something you really want to do. I don't think Deathwing is going to see play here. I mean, Icera is just such a good guaranteed value card. It's hard to justify not running. Definitely. Alright, so we see Emperor Thorison here in Gaara's hand. Nothing out of the ordinary so far from either player.
What do you think the impact of the Emperor is in a no combo deck? Because it's much less impactful.
Definitely, I think that's the strength. The strength of Emperor is to enable combo plays, and I think Druid is especially well tailored for that. I mean, even Handlocks sometimes don't even run Emperor because it has too low of an impact. Their game plan is already well established enough that they don't feel the need to have Emperor. Like, the mana reduction doesn't affect them necessarily as much, but it has seen play. I think, yeah, it's mostly for combo decks, more so than perhaps this type of deck. But then again, look at the curve that he's got now as a result of that. He can throw minions on the board for much cheaper. It's like an extra...
Well, it's basically free innervates.
Yeah.
You have 2 ice blocks, which is kind of blocking your hand in some way right now.
Nicely done, sir. Nicely done. All right.
3, 6, 7, 8, 9 cards in your hand, so you can't play Acolyte of Pain because then then Druid will find a way to overdraw you.
There he might just punish you for that.
Yeah. No dragon for the Blackwing Technician.
Oh, what about Toshley in the spare part and like an Emperor Thorsen? Is that the reason? Like he wants to get a free spare part?
I wouldn't think so.
Is that it? Oh man, this Emperor is getting pretty good value. We're talking about a 5-man Ancient of War and a 3-man Belcher here. If this board is gone, it's gonna come back pretty soon afterwards.
I did say it's less impactful because you have no combo, but when it stays up for 2 turns, that's basically, wow, so much value.
Yeah, it's crazy.
So Gara did draw 3, 6, 12, 13 coins. And it doesn't take a slot in his hand.
Yeah, that sounds good. Also, I realized something about the card that you probably already knew, but if you cast Lotheb, let's say I have a preparation and I have Emperor that stays for 3 turns, and you play Lotheb, prep costs only 2. Because throws the mana cost in the negatives. So the effective mana cost of prep is -3. When you play Lotheb, it goes up to only 2 instead of 5.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so you can effectively have like a coin out of your prep if it stays 3 turns up.
Interesting.
Yeah. I thought that was a little bit of a... I found that interaction sort of interesting because I thought it would just cap the mana cost at 0.
Mm-hmm. Look at this.
What on earth? Oh, what?
What did I say?
Oh, the thing is, he's got to pop the block as soon as possible to keep the Grove, right?
But he can even put him on 1 point of life. You know what's interesting? Without the Emperor, he wouldn't be able to play Swipe and Keeper of the Grove.
Keeper of the Grove,
And the Hero Power in the same turn. So he would have to leave him on 2 points of life instead of 1, which is a huge deal.
So what you're telling me here is that Emperor Thorsen is impactful in Druid.
Yeah, I would say so.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Alright, now Sho knows there's a dragon in Gaur's hand. He's got to suspect the Ysera, but I don't think he'll ever suspect the Deathwing.
He'll be like, oh no, it's Deathwing! No, how can I deal with that? There's a big game hunter popping into his hand.
So, Doomslayer Nova Iceblock, because I don't know, this is really weird. He needs to find himself an Alexstrasza as soon as possible.
But then you lose anyway.
Yeah.
Because you will get 10 points of 10 damage next turn.
You can also just Frostbolt the enemy's face and keep your ice block. Then again, you're dead to Swipe, Force of Nature, Keeper of the Grove number 2. How do you like the Frostbolt face instead of ice block? Because if you ice block, you're wasting it. You're guaranteed to lose it, effectively.
Yeah, that's true. I like that. That's way better than ice blocking.
And now the enemy can't play any minions and... Oh, will we see Belcher Shredder here to spawn 2 minions after the Doomsayer?
Shredder is not bad. I would say it's only Shredder, I think.
Okay.
Because you can get something like a Vitality Totem. Or maybe Lorewalker Cho.
Lorewalker Cho would be funny, trading ice blocks.
Yeah, that would be great.
Do you know the nightmare this would represent for Gaara if that happened? Alright, he's gonna drop 2 minions with the Threadle here. He just needs 1 damage from the slime in effect, so all he's looking for is a bit more stuff on the board. And he finds a Barber. Not an amazing minion, but at least it's something.
And Sho has a problem. He didn't draw any of his Med Scientists. That's the problem.
That would have helped him get some kind of secret out, at the very least. So, having to waste an ice block here feels horrible.
I think he already lost because of that.
He needs to find Alexstrasza right now and heal himself up. That's the only out I think he's got. He's gonna have a few opportunities, well, 2 opportunities, 3 if you count the top deck, to draw her.
Ice Barrier is still an option, because Gaara is lacking a missile, I would say, like a Swipe, an example. Well, in this situation, you just pop the block, right? And do you think, I would say? Maybe drop the Ancient of War.
What if you just drop Deathwing?
Why?
How do you lose?
Because he can't. Then you lose your whole hand.
Yeah. No, I know. There's no way he's going to play. He might not even play Deathwing this game, unfortunately. Oh, there's the Alex.
Oh, wow. Okay.
A little bit of a clutch draw here, to say the least. And he's going to be able to freeze something on the back of that with Ice Lance. Well, something doesn't mean a lot, but...
He still has a problem. Like, a huge problem.
Well, I mean, Alex draws and freeze the Ancient of War is kind of okay.
That's still seven damage on board.
Right. But at least you're alive.
That's true.
That's his only out I can think of.
Maybe not. Maybe just... What are the draws that you're looking for?
I can't think of anything else that would change his turn here. Like, there is nothing that would change the Alex Straza Ice Lance turn. Unless he keeps Ice Lance for Archmage, but there's no more Ice Block, so he needs to find Ice Barrier. I don't think that's very realistic. Alright.
Garolex, any kind of...
Okay, wait, wow! What is Garbrot this tournament? The ultimate anti-hunter deck. If you silence my Doomslayer, you can't silence my Sengins and my Sludge Belchers. So pick your owl targets very carefully, sir.
I'm still thinking about the purpose of the spare part. I mean, of Toshly. Only for body?
Possibly. It's a 5-7, right? For 6. It's like it reminds me of the Fugin argument. People were saying, oh, people are going to run Fugin because it's a 4-7 for 5 and it's got a good body, but it never saw play, despite its good vanilla stats.
Hmm.
Well, maybe that's the reason he's running it. I'm curious, though. I'm really curious. Maybe the added utility of it is what he's looking for. Alright, so there's going to be a good flame strike here for Sho. An amazing flame strike, in fact, I'd say.
That's very true.
And Gaara has no way to come back from it besides Deathwing.
Which is kind of okay.
Yeah, no, it's great. It's a great way to come back, because then you OTK your opponent, unless they have some kind of funky play right away. Oh, man. I cannot believe this. We might see Deathwing. I said we wouldn't, but we might see it.
It all depends on the next draw. Oh, I would. That's awful. You don't want to lose that card when you play Deathwing.
Ancient of Lore Doomslayer? I think Deathwing is too good. You have to Deathwing. What is he going to do to me?
Look at Sho.
Oh, goodness. Oh, finds two freezes.
Oh, that's huge.
Now you Frost Nova Doomsayer and Mad Scientist to get the secret, right? Or do you go for Archmage Nova?
No, you go Archmage Nova.
Yes.
What? What would you... I don't get it. You kill the Deathwing with two Fireballs next turn.
Right. That's what I would do, I think, in this position. But what if he top decks Keeper, right? He silences Deathwing and then punches you in the face, and then you're dead. But that's still true now, so I guess ultimately it's all the same.
Yeah, exactly.
Well...
That's not it.
Oh man, Gaara!
Okay, I know why he did play the Doomsayer instead of Antonitis, because he wanted to get the Ice Barrier as soon as possible.
I think that's a very safe line of play, and now he's...
The second one.
He is more than okay right now.
Now what do? You can't play any spell. So if Gaara has
You can play Nova, yeah, you can play Frost Nova. They don't need to have minions, and I suspect you won't see any of them coming up. No, probably not. I just pink face.
So now Force of Nature, and you killed Antonidas.
Naturalize, go, go, go.
No, what do I say? What I'm saying? No, you have to. You will have to. So Rev, draw one, and hope for Force of Nature. That's basically it.
But he doesn't have that.
So if he doesn't think about Revving first, then he doesn't have an answer to the Antonidas. Like at all.
I don't think he does. I think Keeper of the Grove is the closest he's gonna come, if anything. But, you know, we saw Isera and Deathwing.
Do it, you know?
Wow. I don't even know what I'm looking at, but it's great.
That Deathwing lost him the game. He should have gone with the Ancient of Law, I would say.
I think I agree with you. Deathwing is too cool, but I don't think it was necessarily the best play here, because he could have drawn more cards. The thing is, if you draw cards and you don't find what you need, and then you Deathwing, you lose even more stuff. Like, you don't want to draw before you drop Deathwing. Oh, wow. What a whiff. Wait, Wrath, Archmage, draw Swipe, then Hero Power down Archmage.
Look, if you would play the Ancient of Lore and draw, you could have drawn into Big Game Hunter or two Wraths. Because the Alexstrasza had 3 points of life, right?
Right.
3? Was it 3?
3. I think it was a 3 after attacking the Ancient of War, yeah. Oh, he finds his Sarah Awakens, but that would kill him. That would kill him. If Sho goes full face...
He should go.
He's calculating whether or not a Nightmare would kill him.
Nightmare, no. That's not...
Actually, you know what... Okay, I was going to say, you know what would? Actually, yeah, Swipe kills him. Swipe with Ysera Awakens is lethal, right?
Oh yeah, that's true.
It doesn't even pop the ice barrier. Oh my god.
Second keeper too, right?
Yes.
That's
He's got to find it. He's got to find Swipe or Keeper of the Grove.
Go for it.
You have to go for it, Gaara. You've seen two ice blocks. This is your best chance of getting anything done here.
Well, you have to. You have no other options. You have to rev.
Well, maybe he's thinking, you know, what could I get? Maybe he's only running one swipe, one keeper.
But then you're dead. You can basically concede. So why it's not better just to draw and see?
Yeah, I know.
Instead
he has to
thinking
it.
About it.
Yeah, of course. Swipe! Oh, he finds it!
Whoa! That's so insane.
Will he miss it? No way he does,
No way. He knows it's ice block because he popped two blocks. Seen that.
What if there's a counterspell left in the deck? He should have swiped first. Wow. Alright, well that's game. Gaara picks up the game with Ysera Awakens. The only dream card that would have won the game here, by the way. The only dream card that could have won this. I don't even know what I'm looking at, but Gaara is going to steal a game with his Druid deck. And Sho will not have to face it again, at the very least. So his Dragon Nightmares are now over, I guess. Wow, that was something.
That was really, really a great match. But the problem for Sho was the fact that he couldn't play around it, you know? There was no way to play around Ysera Awakens.
No, you couldn't do it. You have to take a chance. When it's a 20% chance, what are you going to do, right?
Yeah.
There are 5 possible dream cards, so you can't really afford playing around one of them on the off chance that he got it. But that was really the best outcome for Gaara, and that swipe off the top at the very end was also a big deal.
I'm also interested in the fact that if all the spells from all the dream cards from Ysera are being drawn by, you know, random, is it the exact same chance of drawing Ysera Awakens instead of a Laughing Sister, you know? Or is it like rarity based?
No, I've played enough Rendwinrin. I can tell you it's as likely to draw you. Although sometimes you do get streaks of one or the other, you know, it's bound to happen. It is very well distributed. So this will be a 1-1 right now. So Sho is going to be playing as Rogue next up against Gaara's Shaman. Usually, you know, we said last week or the past few weeks that Rogue had a pretty good, you know, shot at beating Shaman, but it's been proven wrong multiple times so far. So I don't really want to make any predictions about what's coming up. And with Gaara's ability to build funky decks, I would like to
see the Fellreaver Shaman. It's very fun to watch.
Yeah, it gets punished. Some people say it gets punished a lot, but you still beat down people. You know, if they mill you, sometimes you still end up winning because of the damage output.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes that doesn't even matter.
True. Well, we'll still have to see how it goes. But if the Shaman is the really aggressive one, he can easily win the matchup against a Rogue. It's like basically, the Rogue has no taunts at all. So if you get Doomsayer, that's basically 16 damage.
Yeah.
To the face.
Well, we'll be entering the game very soon. From what we're seeing, it seems like this is just a typical mid-range Shaman. You were saying how Gaara was, you know, very effective at playing that deck, and there's no reason for him not to. And I think you're right.
So now the problem is that this matchup is really biased towards the Rogue. Unless there will be no... Deadly Poison, Deadly Blade Fury drone, but I think with this sprint already in hand, this might not be an issue at all.
Well, I mean, there is a pretty good start here for Gaara anyway. You know, he's on curve with the Power Mace into Shredder as well. That's pretty solid. I mean, there's going to have to be a sap at some point down the line. So he develops the Power Mace now, gets a Shade on curve, then gets a Shredder to eat up the last charge of the Power Mace.
Mm-hmm. Well,
that's
second
turn to Dagger.
Second backstab is also important. Especially when you can deal with a free health minion on your turn when you play a creature like Baltic Shredder. You have the dagger still intact, you might say. The problem is that the Baltic Shredder, which will be dropped, will be instantly, well, maybe not instantly buffed. What about Sap? Sap is awful then for you.
The thing is, you have to play into Sap because there are multiple lines of play that would be punished by Sap. And if that gets sapped, then your Shade might be able to do something relatively useful. Let's see what comes out of that Shredder first, because we've been surprised in the past. A RoboCup, that does nothing.
RoboCup, nice.
Well, there goes the sap. How big of a drawback is that? You see the Harrison Jones right now at Galar's hand, actually. Very, very strong card here in this matchup. It's gonna come in handy sometime down the line.
Shaman has a really big problem against the Rogue. Like, you have to burn the board because that's how you win with the mid-range Shaman, right? Without any kind of creatures on board, there's no way of winning this matchup at all. So a single Blaze Flurry with an upgraded weapon almost always means game.
Yeah, one board wipe is enough to take you off the game, effectively. If they get one good flurry, you're effectively thrown out. And funny enough, Sho does have the board here against the Shaman. They both play somewhat similarly, it's just that Rogue has a slight edge because of the way their cards operate.
Emperor, again!
Yeah, 4-man Harrison Jones in the future.
That's nice. A 1-mana Flame Totem is really, really great. Oh, that's huge pickup here.
Yeah, getting that sprint for 4 mana is going to be... you can then eviscerate and trade with your dagger if you want to, and keep your 3-3s, and then you've got a full hand. A full enough hand, at least.
Do you do it right now? I think you do. You have no other options to play, so you do play prep sprint. Hope for a Deadly Poison Blade Flurry just to have it already in hand so you can adjust your game plan to the next and upcoming turns. What about sapping the Emperor?
And just pressing for 6 damage to deadly Tinker's Eviscerate on the following turn? You know what? I don't even think that's too bad. And that seems like a good play because he still has to replay it eventually.
Shaman has no taunts unless it's a Defender of August, and you won't see that Emperor anyway. With Defender, I mean, because you will have to replay the whole 6-point of mana creature. So you gain with a single sap, you lose a card, but you gain 4 points of mana, so it's basically like almost a one turn.
Alright, so let's see what Sho does here. He's got 3 on board. Deadly Tinkers, that's another 2 plus 6. He's got another 8 damage there. He's actually, with Eviscerate, he would have had lethal right now, I think.
You sure? Oh, I wasn't sure.
I'm pretty sure he would have it right now if he'd gone for that line of play instead.
15, so that's... He would have still the durability. But that doesn't matter because he doesn't have the Blaze Flurry. So 2, 5, 6, 8,
yeah.
11, 15. Yeah, exactly lethal with Eviscerate.
So Eviscerate would have made the difference, but he played it really safe. Yeah, he would have been able to deal a bit more because of the first dagger hit and everything. It would have been...
It would be 16 points of damage.
Well, let's see what Sho does about this board.
You know, the reasoning of sapping Emperor is the fact that he already made the battle cry, right? Sorta. And
yeah.
then if you want to replay him, you basically you don't gain anything that turn. So
well,
you
it's wasted,
you lose
a,
yeah, you lose another turn. So why would you replay the Emperor? So the sap would mean Emperor gets destroyed for 2 points of mana.
In effect, yeah, I mean there's no time at which Garo's gonna be able to replay it really.
Yeah.
Now Sho's gonna go for the deadly poison tinker's play. And punch face for a solid 11 damage. 12 actually, I lied.
So next turn, sprint into the last Evis or Blade Flurry. If, you,
well,
if there would be a taunter, right? Because if you, there's no taunt minion, then you just attack face and win the game.
So Harrison Jones has to be played here, I think. You have to Harrison Jones, possibly Lothab right afterwards, and then Earthshock, the SI.
What about... Well, the Lothab is okay, yeah.
I think Harrison Jones might open up your options. This Earthshock for free allows Gaara to get aboard.
I think you trade for the agent and play Lothab.
Yeah. Well, you trade or you play Earthshock first to make sure your Fire Ally doesn't die so you can actually punch face for possible close to lethal afterwards. We'll have to see what Gaara finds, but if he finds the Wind Fury or Bloodlust, it could be really close.
5, 10, 16. So he's 9 of lethal. He gains 4 with the Flame Talk, so that's 5. What would he need to draw?
A good Crackle, Wind Fury, Bloodlust.
Oh wow, Blade Flurry. Would have been lethal if not that Harrison Jones. Even with the Lothab.
So Azure Drake, Eviscerate is... actually, there's no way that Sho wins right now unless he finds the South Sea Deckhand. That's not the South Sea Deckhand. Oh man, Sho's got to be a little afraid with that board. He's seen Gaara punch him out of like punch people out of games with Bloodlust. It's got to be a little worrying. Well, when you're all in, you're all in. Let's see what he does. Gaara finds the Noyotron.
Wow, that's such a huge pickup, but there's a sap. So I would say you have to hero power. Do you have to? You have 25% of being even remotely. No, you have 75% to fail because other totems are just basically blanks.
Useless. Yeah, they won't do anything. So I think maybe just the hex trade and then trade one of your minions into the other one and then play an Noyotron is fine with the possible double shredder. In fact,
yeah, I would agree with that.
I mean, it depends. Like, I mean, you can only play one shredder if you go for the hex play, but
and Sho has so many ways of dealing lethal. If you draw deadly poison, eviscerate. No, second Blade Fury doesn't make it, but...
SI7 would, I think.
SI7, SI7 would. And what else? What else? Second Tinker Shrub's Oil. So here's like... One Eviscerate, one Agent, one Tinker Shrub's Oil, and one Agent. So 4 outs.
Yeah, but now he needs to find them right now.
And
he has no dagger developed at the moment. Oh,
Drake, so still one more chance.
Actually, oh man, a prep would do it too. Azure Drake, prep, sap, dagger up, attack phase, blade flurry for 2.
So what about sprint? I don't know how many cards does he have in this deck, but
yeah, eviscerate would do it, right?
Yeah, eviscerate would be lethal. And if you go into prep deadly poison, then it's still
you still win. Yeah, prep deadly would win. I think you have to try it out. I mean, I don't know how safe you feel otherwise, right?
Yeah, I think you have to go for sprint. Sprint into... Agent doesn't do much. So the only thing you can draw is the deadly poison prep or eviscerate.
Yeah, straight up. And I think, depending on the amount of cards you got left in your deck, which I wish I could see, because that way we'd calculate whether or not
Tinker
the risk is worth taking.
Is also worth it. Because then you have... But you have to get the prep.
Yeah, you can't really do it. There's he finds
prep,
the prep.
And the agent, so... And it
Whoa!
Is
he finds the lethal.
Wow.
That was a really close call. Prep and Blade Flurry will work here. Whoa, what a top deck here off of Sprint. Then again, he did draw two Sprints. One Azure Drake was played for card draw, so he takes the win against Shaman. That was a really close game.
He could have also sap the Anoitron instead of Blade Fury. So he had,
I mean, yeah, he would have been able to go phase just straight up instead. And an Unstable Ghoul came out of the Shredder, but that did nothing. So that is going to be game 2 for Sho. So he's up 2-1 against Gaara, who's going to be able to reuse this Shaman. Sho has only one deck left, his Freeze Mage, I believe.
Yeah, that's true. So Freeze Mage against Paladin.
And Shaman. I would say Freeze Mage is generally fairly favored in these matchups.
I would think so.
Yeah, it's might be an uphill battle for Gaara here. Unless he's got some fancy techs in that Paladin deck, like Kazan Mystics. Kazan Mystic Paladin? Double Kazan Mystic Paladin.
Well, if he plays double Lay on Hands, Holy Light, and the keyboards, yeah, then it's not a problem to play against.
It would be kind of nice, actually, to see a really control-heavy Pally with, you know, the maximum healing potential. Double heal bot, double lay on hands is usually enough to get you through. Mm-hmm. So just that alone would be really nice to see. I'll have to see what Gaara decides to bring. I mean, we saw a really fancy Druid deck coming from him. So maybe he's going to be preparing for Dragon Consort already with Dragon set up in his Paladin deck. You know, because he can play Saren control Pally, right?
Yeah, he can. He can, that's true.
So, oh, man. Hand Paladin with Giants and Drakes.
Hand Paladin. I was talking with... Who was I talking to? I think Kriparin about Fate for Priest and a Giant Priest, if that card would be still available for us.
Yeah, I think it would be great, honestly. It would be really nice to play with.
True.
It's one of the cards that I regret Priest lost. They used to have no use for it, but then it, like, right now it'd be just amazing.
I think it would be broken for 2 points of mana.
Yeah. At the moment it would. When it got released initially, Priests were complete trash, but they have changed quite a bit.
Like, the card was a cantrip. It drew a card after it was played for 2 points of mana and gave all your minions taunts. That's just crazy, dude.
It's like a massive Sunfear. It's a massive Sunfear protector, effectively. The thing is, as Priest, you rarely have too many minions on the board. So as a result, you typically don't get much more than a Sunfear protector out of it. On average, you really just don't get much more, but you could maybe swap the archetype to where Fate is better than Sunfury. It just turned out to be really hard to justify
running back in Sunfury the days. Was also giving taunt to every single minion.
Did it?
Yeah, it did. And they changed it. The same patch, they...
I don't remember that. Oh, wow, okay.
When Fate was changed... I mean, Fate was basically thrown out of the game.
Yeah, removed.
It was the same patch that Sunfury was changed to give the only the two minions on the left and the right of his side giving taunt.
You're right. It used to say your other minions gain taunt.
Yeah, you basically dropped
and then it became
whatever.
Adjacent. You're right. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, that was crazy.
That was a really insane card, but no one was using it at that time.
It was. Well, Handlock was playing it back then, back in Alpha. It was changed. People were trying out like the Twi Drake, Mountain Giant, Molten Handlock play, which was kind of funny. People even tried out, you know, playing Pit Lords to justify the health loss to accelerate the Molten's. That never really worked. It was experimental phase of Hearthstone back in Alpha, but Sunfury was definitely in there, and so was Sylvana Shadowflame with Power of Whelming. That was also on the broken end. I mean, she was everywhere, effectively, in closed beta.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Sylvana's Brawl for 10 points of mana.
All right, so we'll be seeing Shaman versus Mage. So Gaara will stick to his Shaman before moving on to his Paladin, so we'll see... One more match versus
Mage. So he thinks
Mage.
Shaman has better chances against the Mage, right?
He has to, because tiebreaker points matter enough that you want to get those. So by staying with your best possible matchup, you want to get yourself the best matchup possible to get those tiebreakers. So if Sho... I mean, Shaman is such a rough matchup, like a rough class to play up against a Mage.
It's
I mean, I'd
awful.
Feel really sad about that.
It's awful, really awful.
Do you think Sho targeted the Shaman from Gaara? Let's think about that for a second.
Yeah, I think you're right.
That might have been his entire lineup's planning. Hunter, Mage, Freeze Mage, and then the Rogue? I think so, yeah. True, that seems true. Realistic.
Very true. This might be right. Mana Tide Totem, which also is crucial against Freeze Mage, I would say. If you want to get something from you know, to flood the board. Shaman, to be able to flood the board after the wipes, he has to draw cards. And what what is the best way for the Shaman to draw cards?
Only Mana Tide is the only tool they've really got at their disposal at the moment.
So this card might be very important in this matchup. Earthshock would be insane here.
It'd be nice at the very least. Well, we're more likely to see a Shade.
Yeah, we have to.
If the Shade is allowed to grow unimpeded, this could be problematic.
You think so? I don't think it's a factor. You have a Doomsayer and Frosnova, so...
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. Like, if it's allowed, if somehow he manages to get it to stick on the board, you know, he deflects a Doomsayer, and then it doesn't die to AoE at a certain point. That could be a big deal. We'll have to see, though, what comes out. There's a lot of card draw here for show.
What about Unshading right now? Killing the Acolyte of Pain? If you dropped Mana Tide Totem, you probably will do that.
Does he or does he just trade with a 2-1 and passes? He does trade, alright.
I would do the same.
Well, he's going to get a bit of card draw here. Harrison,
it's a shame there's
exactly
a Frostbolt, but now the reasoning behind trading is that the fact that the Frostbolt has to be used on something, so it won't be used on the Mana Tide Totem most likely. But how can you anticipate both Doomsayer and Frostbolt at the same time? It's still 6 points of damage, so in Garalax 1 point of mana or 1 point of damage to kill the Doomsayer.
Yeah, he's so close. Like, it would be able to play Defender of Argus plus Flame Tongue to kill the Doomsayer, but because he can, that's going to be a dead weight. At least he's going to get his card draw off the Mana Tide, so two cards drawn off of it is better than nothing.
So, Hero Power.
For value.
Oh, he didn't. Wow.
Yeah.
I'm disappointed.
You want to keep your RNG luck for later when you really need it.
Maybe you want to get the unlucky totems right now to get it later.
That's not how Shaman works, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Garo knows best.
What do you think about making... would it matter? Would be even maybe worse than random if you make it those totems popping up at a certain order? In a certain order? What do you think about that?
I've always, you know, somewhat disliked the RNG factor of it, but I've come to accept it. At this point, I've lost a legit design opinion on it. I feel like it's something that people are used to playing around with, to the point where a lot of the time when you're not playing against decks like these, sometimes all the totems end up coming out. But, you know, the spell power being so strong and Stone Claw being so strong a lot of the time makes it so the RNG of it just adds a layer of unpredictability that's not necessarily necessary, right, in the game. There's already a lot of that with Shredders and even just a starting hand in Mulligan.
Imagine Shaman with the old totem that healed himself. I mean, healed the character, the hero itself.
Yeah, the healing totem that healed the Shaman at the same time with everything else. That would be crazy.
This might be the card that Shaman needs to be, like, on the top, you know? Because then Face Hunter has to always kill the totem.
Yeah. Well, Gaara's going to be finding a Lothab here, which is going to be really important because Sho cannot play anything here. Frostnova cannot come down until 8 mana hits.
Well, he can use Ice Lance.
Wow, what a great play.
Is it important? You will get 15 points of damage. Basically, Ice Lance is like a healing touch.
It is a 1 mana. You're losing an OTK card. So he's just got to calculate whether or not he needs the OTK with it. I think you have to freeze anyway, because 8 is a lot of damage.
Yeah.
Like, you have the 2 Novas, so that could play in your favor.
And Shaman won't play anything at all next turn. I think he will just Hero Power up and pass.
Or Defend of Argus.
Really?
The one of the two minions, possibly. I wouldn't even mind that because it puts them out of flame strike range. For the
oh, you're
being.
Right. Wait, what?
Just the one. All right.
Why just the one?
Just the one.
Because?
I'm sorry.
Garra didn't even made a move, right?
Okay, wait. I'm trying to figure out what
wait,
it is.
Wait. Is it the picture? I'm confused.
Garra, yeah, the Garra. This is a picture. Garra doesn't have a webcam, or he's frozen into place.
Okay, no.
Well, Garra doesn't even flinch. He's not blinking.
Still, you know.
Yeah. Never blink. That's what I was taught. Well, there's the double Nova, so attacking with those minions, no matter what, is going to be pretty tricky. I think the reason why you buff up the 5-4 is that way it lives through a blizzard, but I don't know why you wouldn't buff the Lothab. That's the one thing I'm curious about.
You gain the damage also.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm trying to figure out, maybe it's to allow for better rotation on the Flame Tongue, so that when the Lothab dies, then the Pile of Shredder gets it.
What?
I don't know, that's the only reason I can think of, but I don't even get it myself. Well, a 2-1, that's no help. And now a perfect ping on Lothab. Goodbye. There's an Emperor here in Sho's hand. A card that I think is really nice to have seen added to the Mage Art. I think Freeze Mage is another deck that benefited a lot from it. The ability to get so many cards being playable. Yeah, it's a crazy deck.
With Antonite, this is just insane. You can drop Antonidas for 6 points of mana and get a Frostbolt Ice Lance for 1 point of mana. So that's basically cost of an Antonidas. So for cost of an Antonidas, you get 3 fireballs. Free fireballs.
Yeah, Emperor really did enable combo decks to crop up as a legitimate archetype.
Look at this. This is just insane. I
was expecting Emperor Thorison with Nova.
I would still play Emperor here.
Yeah, that's what I thought he would do, but he's going to play it a bit slower. And honestly, I don't really blame him. I think it's ultimately pretty okay. And he's going to be able to get his value later on anyway. Ah, there's a useless Storm.
Yeah, the Storm is awful.
Well, you got to do it though, right?
Yeah.
Bad as it is.
I think that the Divine Shield should mitigate the freezing effects.
Like armor used to, right?
Yeah, like armor used to. And then they changed it so water elementals are really good now.
Yeah, water elementals got much better after that change. They were already good, but they got much, much stronger.
So now you Frost Nova. Weird, right?
Do you even Frost Nova? Or do you just want the mana reduction once so you can spam everything with Archmage? Yeah, I like this. I think this is a bit more in line with what he might have wanted to do initially anyway. It's not a bad Drake. Could get an OTK on that Emperor.
OTK on Emperor.
Yeah, it's important to get the OTK on minions. Well, it's more like an OAK, like one action kill. There you go.
He got it. Snipe. Headshot.
360 no scope, 420 no blaze scope. It.
Yeah.
All right. Well.
SMG from 50 meters.
Is this the turn where you play Archmage, or you just wait a little bit and you just go for a flame strike?
You have ice block, right?
Yeah, he's already set up.
Because his ice block in the hand is not green. Mm-hmm. So, I would like to see Antonidas. I think you have Pyroblast and 2 fireballs in your hand.
He's trying to starve Garra for cards, and Garra is obliging. I mean, he is currently starving for really good cards to play. Like, he's got pretty decent options, but are they enough
the
to apply pressure to pop the ice blocks, right?
That was the thing I said at the start of the game. The mana type totem is crucial in this situation. If you can just keep up with the cards that can mage draw, then maybe Shaman can somehow win this matchup. But otherwise, he will get just outvalued in the long run.
Is this a fireball play or a Nova play?
No, I would say it's a Nova play.
Alright. Well, cycling the Icelands for a fireball. Not too shabby. He gets to kill the water, the fire Ellie at the same time. So how do you freeze a fire Ellie? Can you explain that to me? How do you get... I mean, his thermal signature to be low enough that... you can actually freeze it. Whoa, alright, so Gar just leaves this game and Sho is going to be taking the series 3-1. I think his lineup was targeting Shaman for Gaara very, very heavily. We saw three classes that they deal very well with Shaman in general, and I think Gaara's exploitable little niche there was picked up because Gaara has brought Shaman pretty much every week so far.
Yeah, I have to agree with you. Sho had really stepped up with his game, so... targeting the Shaman is something really important against Gaara, and he did well with that. He would go 3-0 if not that if not that Ice Star Awakens.
Right? Yeah, that Ice Star Awakens was really close here for Gaara. It was the one card that could have saved him, so that win that he got might have not been a win like 80% of the time, effectively.
Exactly, 80% of the time.
Yep. So that was a really close one there. And also he got a swipe at the end, which was also important on top of Ysir Awakens. So it was a mix of his deck and getting that Ysir Awakens that made the difference. But Sho is going to be taking the first series of the day here up against Gaara. We'll be casting Shrivecrow versus Zixo afterwards. Again, I mentioned it earlier, right. But both players, all those players, you know, Sho, Gaara, Shrivecrow, and Zixo have had their scores adjusted as a result of Masan dropping out of the league. So Shrivecrow lost a win, Sho lost a win, Gaara and Zixo had one of their losses recovered, effectively. So they lost a loss, so effectively they're a little further ahead than they were before. And Zixo is going to be going up against the leading player of the entire event, Shrivecrow, who's currently 100% win rate, and Zixo
insane,
wins.
Right?
That's going to be a pretty good confidence boost. Yeah, it's insane. Yeah,
a team can't handle that. No way.
You can't beat me? You think you can beat me?
I think you can't beat Shrivecrow, man.
I'm pro at the games. You know, Shrivecrow's a pro at the games. He plays Hearthstone like poker. When you make $300,000 a year. When I'm me, you can't do that. Like me. Rank 1 legend. Top 20 legend at 21. I'm the best player in the world. Beat that, Shrivecrow. So basically, Shrivecrow is an amazing player, and Athene can't handle it. So on this note, I guess we'll be taking a 10-minute break. We'll be right back with Shrivecrow versus Zixo. It should be an interesting series. Hopefully, we see some Mage and Paladin action coming from Shrivecrow, two classes that I love to see him play. So on this note, guys, we'll be right back. Kingwin Pro League 2015, do not go anywhere.